You. You'll notice up in the front we have a Trinity candle. Trinity recognizing that there is a unity in diversity. And I am so delighted to look around the room and recognize the strength that is present in the diversity that is present. So thank you for reflecting the beauty of God by the diversity that we share. And then there are rocks, which in our community, I have brought them in to remind us the foundation upon which everything stands, which is love. And so as a reminder of that, feel free to take a rock when you go. They'll be around the edges of the room. Without further ado, we have such a full agenda. I will share the space with Corey. He disappeared. He's good at doing that. He's talking to the press.
He's tweeting.
And here I'm just
standing. Normally, I
hear
a talk at 6:30 in the morning and send out my tweet. Oh.
So, what am I doing? Are we blessing? No. All right. So, let us pray. God, you are the God of all of us. And you delight and call each one of us beloved. Help us to take in that truth for ourselves, and help us to see and know that truth in the faces of all whom we meet. We ask your blessing upon this time together, that we may be nourished and strengthened to be your light and your love in the world around us. In your holy name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
Coming around, is a clipboard. If you would like to be alerted to things like this, put your name and email address, and if you don't wish to do that, that's just fine. But we thought with so many wonderful people gathered, if we could gather that information, we'd be delighted.
I want to particularly, first I just need to say, this is beautiful. This is America. Yeah. This is America. How about a round of applause? This is America. It's many shapes and colors, many faith traditions, many ethnic backgrounds, roots to many nations. This is what we stand for in this country. Isn't that right?
Yes.
Yeah. And as people of faith, I can only say that when we gather together as Muslims, Jews, Sikhs, Christians, and other faiths that might be present with us even, we see more clearly the immense, powerful, and unimaginable beauty of God. Isn't that true?
Yes.
That's right. And that's why it's so important that we keep coming together. One, to protect the values in our nation that we all hold dear, that are also so ingrained in each religious tradition here. We need to keep coming together because that God of all our faith traditions is at this time in our nation calling for people to go out and protect the vulnerable, especially vulnerable migrants, vulnerable refugees, and faith traditions who are vulnerable to because of misinformation and hate that's being spread. So we're here answering that call that has come through all those traditions. Isn't that right?
Yes.
All right. Amen. And the Children of Abraham Coalition, I am honored to be a co-founder, particularly with my sister Shaheen. You have to stand up real quickly. She, yes. She's got the most stylish hijab in the world. And so, we were founded about 6 years ago as a result of hate at that period of time, when a Christian pastor made international news with his desire to burn the Holy Quran. And so, with the help of my sister Shaheen from the Islamic Education Center, and then with the help of leadership from Temple Chai in Long Grove, anyone from Temple Chai here, we formed a network that as a coalition that now includes the voices of many synagogues, Christian churches, and mosques. And in addition to that, as Abrahamic traditions, we are now more and more partnering with our brothers and sisters in the Sikh tradition. And that is such a blessing. So, today, we're here at a very important moment. Under the direction of our new president, our immigration and enforcement officers have been directed to prioritize practically all undocumented immigrants for deportation. Although the president has said that he only wants to deport the bad hombres, the people who are convicted of violent crimes, indeed his direction tell otherwise. His executive order identifies that all those who he considers as violent criminals are anyone who has been charged with a crime, anyone who could become a public burden, or anyone who has violated any of our immigration laws. So that means anyone who is here undocumented. In fact, my heart was rent yesterday when I saw a video of a man being followed as a man who had been followed as by immigration enforcement as he dropped his children off at school. And they apprehended him at the school. And the video is his children crying. He had committed a drunk driving offense 10 years ago. So it's so important that we are here listening to that call of the God of all faiths, who is now calling out for people of faith to protect these vulnerable brothers and sisters, those people who have so enriched our nation and so enriched our lives. And we're here today to do this in a special way. We are here in this holy space because our holy spaces, whether they be gurdwaras, mosques, churches, or synagogues, have been the center of our lives, right? They have motivated and healed and sent us and inspired us and strengthened us and healed us. And so we're here today to listen to the beauty of these faith traditions as a representative from each speaks about what that tradition guides us to do as we look at immigrants, how each tradition guides our treatment of immigrants. And so what I want to do is we have four speakers, and I will introduce them and then invite them one at a time to come forward. Let me introduce the speakers. From the Sikh community of Palatine, which is the largest Sikh community in the Chicago area, and Parminder Singh, if you just stand real quickly, Parminder. From Congregation Beth Am, a long time, since the very beginning as well, part of the Children of Abraham Coalition, and someone who's become a dear friend, and she's a wonderful activist. Rabbi Lisa Bellows will speak from the church. A new friend to the Children of Abraham Coalition is the Muslim Community Center in Morton Grove, and they are so focused on interfaith work that we really wanted to invite them, and very honored to have Imam Nazim Majera here. He will speak for them. And then, from the Christian tradition, a retired pastor who no pastor's ever really retired. Yeah. Probably the same with imams and rabbis and religious leaders in the Sikh tradition. Reverend Diane Shields, who currently ministers here, will speak from the Christian tradition. So thank you, Reverend. Now, what we'll do is we'll listen to the speakers, and then what's more important is work on the behalf of the vulnerable. Doesn't just come from the head, it comes from relationships. You know, we're working to form that beloved community that Dr. King talked about. And so we will spend time today standing up on our feet, getting to know each other. Okay, we may do that in the middle of the presentations, we may do it at the end. We'll just play it by ear. But first, what I'd like to do is to start us off with by inviting Parminder Singh to come forward. And Parminder, Mr. Singh, was born and raised in the Chicagoland area. He's the eldest son of immigrants who came from East Punjab in India back in the 70s. He is an engineering manager in the consumer market space with 14 years of professional experience, served as vice president of the Sikh Students Association at UIC from 2000 2002, and is also a member of the Sikh community in Palatine. He's an active student of the Sikh Path Scripture, the Guru Granth, and he is recently involved in activism to stop the use of styrofoam in the Palatine Gurdwara due to health and environmental risks. And Parminder, please come forward.
Thank you so much, Corey. Before I begin, I want to make one slight, because there is the Abrahamic traditions, which are present here today, the Sikh faith does not belong in, is not a part of that line of the Abrahamic faiths. So I want to give a quick kind of some points and some framework of where I'm coming from. There are religious leaders like the Imam from the Muslim community, a rabbi from the Jewish community, and a father, a priest. There is this religious leader. I am not a ordained or any sort of religious leader from our community. There is no priesthood in the Sikh faith. The ability, the permission to lead the congregation is given to those who are committed Sikhs, or those who are committed and have taken the translation is baptism, the English word is baptism, but those who have made the commitment to follow the Sikh path in word and deed. And that community is what leads our congregation. So I wanted to make that very clear, because there are slight differences in our traditions and where we're coming from. With that said, we're here to talk about immigration and what's happening in... Actually, the interesting thing is that this is not something that only impacts this country. We were referring to Martin Luther King Jr., and he said, injustice anywhere leads to injustice everywhere. So what we're dealing with is not an American problem. It's not a problem because of the Trump administration. This is a fallacy. This is a delusion. This is a distraction from reality. The fact of the matter is, do you think that we have a new president and because of this one president now all the hate mongers are coming out? Hate was always amongst us. Hate can manifest itself at any moment. And even the faithful. This whole concept of the other, the faithful use it all the time, just being honest. Faiths have used it from time beginning. Religious leaders use it to pit us against each other, the other. Political leaders use it to get into power. This play of the other is not unique to the Trump administration. Salem witch trials. First the Anglo-Saxons came, the people from England came, and then the Germans were the other. And then the Irish were the other. Then the Italians were the other. African Americans were the other for a long time. Women were the other, until they got the right to vote. And now, the brown people are the other, and the brown people are mixed among. The Mexicans are the other, the Muslims are the other, the Sikhs are the other. We're always looking for the other. Because if we're not looking at the other, it forces us to look at ourselves. And how many people want to actually sit down and say, hey, what am I? With that premise is where I want to begin. God, the concept of God, from the Sikh faith, there is only one. And not just only one God. There is only one. If there is only one, there is no other. If there is no other, there is no other creation. There is no me or you, Muslim or Sikh. You know how, as I'm a parent, I have two children, a 7-year-old and a 5-year-old. You know, we look at our children and we say, oh, this child has your eyes. He has his mother's eyes, his father's ears, and so forth, right? If we claim to believe in God, what do you think all of this is? If there is only one, what is all this? Did someone else create you? Did someone else create the Hindu, the Muslim, the Sikh? If you truly believe, because belief can be pretty weak. You can believe something, and in your life you do something totally opposite. In Sikhi, that's called Dubda. Where your words and your actions don't meet up. The other, why is there the other? Do we really believe that there's one God? If we really do, then there really is no difference between us. And the signs are everywhere. And I'm talking literally. I drove down the street in my neighborhood and there's a sign that says, drive like your kids live here. What does that mean? See yourself in other people. When you're going 80 miles an hour in the suburban street, drive like your kids live there. So the signs literally are out there. And if you want to take it at even a bigger macro level, have you ever seen a body reject a Muslim heart? If there's a Christian who needs a heart transplant, has a doctor ever said, it's not going to work, the heart is Muslim? The signs are everywhere, folks. I'm sorry, they're everywhere. This is not even a belief thing. This is where Sikhs come from. And for a Sikh, who gets rid of this parda, this curtain in front of our eyes? It's the Guru. The Guru is the light that dispels the darkness of ignorance. It's all in front of us. God doesn't say, you know what, for this century, I'm with the Muslims, man. They're my people. The rest, they're going to be in trouble for the next couple centuries. This air we breathe, the sunlight shining down on us, there is no prejudice. It's out there for us to see. God's universal being is in front of us. And for the Sikh, the Guru is the one that makes us realize this. And the word Allah is used in the Islamic tradition, God, the Christian tradition, and others. The word, an expression we use, actually the word, because it is all one, the word Allah is used in the Guru Granth, which is the Sikh holy scripture. The word Ram is used, Ramya, which is that God, that being, which is everywhere, here, there, everywhere. There's no place that God is not. You cannot point to a place where there that, you know, that galaxy far other God is not there. God is everywhere, all-encompassing. So, but there is a special expression and term that we use to say God, and that's Waheguru. So I told you who, for a Sikh, gets rid of that curtain in front of my eyes that doesn't allow me to see the unity in creation, the unity of creation, and God in everyone. It's that Guru, that light. And when you do see how infinite God's diversity is, and that Guru who lets you see that, you say, wow. This is a very, very big world. Wow, my mind has made it so small. I thought it was just me living in Arlington Heights. But man, it's huge. In Trump's words, it's huge. It's really huge. And so Sikhs say, Waheguru. Waheguru. Wow. And the greeting, when a Sikh meets another Sikh, or when a Sikh is going to greet the congregation in the Gurdwara. We say, Waheguru Ji Ka Khalsa. Khalsa comes from Farsi. Khalis, pure, unadulterated. Those who are pure in word and deed, they are one with God. Waheguru Ji Ka Khalsa, the sisterhood and brotherhood of those who are true in word and deed are one with God. Waheguru Ji Ka Khalsa, Waheguru Ji Ki Fateh. Fateh is also from Farsi, and the Islamic tradition means victory. When I'm here to introduce myself and greet myself, when a Sikh is greeting another Sikh or a congregation, when we are one with what is, we'll always be victorious. The sun comes up, goes down, the world is moving along. Who wins at the end of every day? It's the will of God. The Raza, which is also a common concept, right? We can relate to these things. The Raza, the will, the hukam of God, it's before us and it wins every time. We've had periods where these things keep coming up. Immigration, this immigration issue is not new. It's related to the other. The other has led to many things. Slavery, the inequality between men and women, immigration, the other, there is no other. So one of the topics we had to discuss, please tell me about time, I'm very small. So we are to give an example from our religious scripture that relates to this concept of how do we approach immigration and the issues that are encompassing it. And in the Sikh path, you don't have to go very far. It's the first line. The Sikh scripture starts with the numeral one. Ik Onkar, one infinite. There is only one. If there are two, then that's duality. There is only one. What's his name? What's that one infinite's name? I'm Parminder. This body is Parminder. There's a certain amount of time. Some we go young, some we go old. This body called Parminder, the actions associated with this image, is time-bound. But God is eternal. That potential, that infinite one, which is everywhere, not just in another external place, everywhere within us, in every space and interspace. And that one infinite's name is truth. Eternal truth, not time-bound truth. Ik Onkar Satnam Karta Purkh. And God is not removed. This potential is not removed and watching. God is within, here, present, and creative and can do. It's not idle. Karta Purkh Nir. How can we operate from this one? Nirpao. Nirvair, without hate, without fear, without hatred. Hate breeds fear. Fear breeds hatred. They're interrelated. So if God is not prejudiced or malice, and we're seeing it, then there can be no hatred in that one potential. There is no fear. If there's only one, there's no other to fear. One of the excuses we make is, you know, we really need to start having more interfaith events because we don't know about each other. You know what? Not knowing about each other is no excuse to hate. Mm-hmm. Because I'm going to be honest with you, I'm not going to sit in a church and lie to you. I'm probably not going to get around to reading the Quran. I'm probably not going to get around to reading the Torah or the Bible. Our Holy Scripture is there. I mean, if I can read that, I think I would consider my life a success. There's a lot to read. And a lot of you are probably not going to get around to reading all the scriptures of the world. And you're not going to get to know about everyone. People are confusing Sikhs with Muslims and this, and I can't complain because I don't know the difference between a Ukrainian and a Polish. Right? We're not going to get around to it. So this is no excuse. Without fear, without hatred, nirbal, nirvair, akal murad. What does God look like? Is he a dude with red hair? He's the image of the undying. Because God is never born, never dies. Akal murad, ajuni, sapang, self-created. No, because there's only one, no other entity created God. Ik Onkar Satnam Karta Purkh Nirpao Nirvair Akal Murat Ajuni. Does not born, and because whatever is born has to die. Sapam. Self-created. And all of this is through the grace of the Guru, Guru Prasad. That is the first line of the sixth scripture. There is only one. And these issues that keep coming up about black and white and immigrants and non-immigrants, they become a moot point. So from the Sikh tradition, this is how we approach this immigration dialogue that is taking place. Yeah. Thank you for your time.
Gara of yours and your community well, and how about that? Man. If we were in the Baptist church, we might be yelling, preach it! Preach it! Now I'd like to invite Rabbi Lisa Bellows, Senior Rabbi at Congregation Beth Am in Buffalo Grove. Rabbi Bellows, how long have you been there, Rabbi?
2001.
16 years.
Wow.
Rabbi Bellows is very active in Movement for Justice. She is, in just a few weeks ago, her congregation held a interfaith rally on for the benefit of immigrants. Her congregation is continually trying to instill in real life time the Jewish concept of tikkun olam, which is healing the world. I have been honored to get to know her these last 6 years, and you're going to be honored, you'll know you'll be honored, once you've heard her talk about Jewish tradition and migrants. So, Rabbi Bellows. We always joke, people who speak for religious congregations, whenever you tell them to you know, you give them a period of time, you always got to say, we like to talk.
So I asked for the reminder.
Yeah.
Really, so great, so beautiful. I feel like there's an expression that we have, all the rest is commentary. All the rest is commentary. I all recognize that there are kids here.
Yeah.
And how important is it to pass these values on to the next generation? There are consequences. There would be consequences for us not to be here. Make sense? So, thank you for being here, and our time is valuable, and the choices that we make can either bring darkness to the world or bring light. And this has brought so much more light. So in the middle of the middle book of the Torah, five books of Moses, is the commandment to welcome the stranger. I want to talk about what it means for us to welcome the stranger, and then maybe some action items. So in the middle of Torah, take a pin to the middle, you're going to get, the stranger who resides within you shall be to you as one of your citizens. You shall love each one as yourself, for you are strangers in the land of Egypt. I, the Lord your God, am the Eternal. That's the core. You know, Jewish self-identity has, from the very beginning, been informed by the fact that we have pretty much always been strangers. Beginning with Adam and Eve, they were kicked out of the home they knew. So embedded in our story is the reality that we are strangers. And you know that collective memory? The idea that we are strangers is passed down through our stories and our teachings in every generation. It informs our values and traditions, our very existence as a people. For example, in the Jewish year, every year we celebrate Passover. You might have heard of it, right? We are required to have guests, to have strangers at the Passover table, the Passover Seder, it's called. The word Seder means order. There's an order to the Seder, and it begins with remembering that we were strangers in the land of Egypt. And in fact, the rabbis, our sages of so long ago, think that it is so important for us to have strangers at the Seder table. They define strangers, and they say, just because you don't know them, that's not good enough. You have to make sure that nobody at the table knows them either. It can't be like your friend's next door neighbor. It could be, but they're talking about to make sure you go out of your way to find a stranger, to find somebody who might be in need of a meal, who might be in need of remembering that there is hope in liberation. The next part, or the important part of the Seder, is to remember to have hope and to remember that not only were we slaves, not only were we strangers in Egypt, but we were liberated. The greatest teacher, Moses, he named his son Gershom, meaning a stranger there. We're never to forget, because when we forget that we were a stranger, we could do to them like what was done to us. It doesn't feel good to be a stranger. Not only does it create separation, and there is no separation, it creates a sense of power imbalance. We're all created in the image of God. Not just some of us, but all of us. There are 36 commandments in the Torah that deal with taking care of the stranger. 36, most amount of commandments dedicated to one thing: take care of the stranger. The first time in Exodus, we read, you shall take care of a stranger because you were strangers in the land of Egypt. But we need clarification because we don't actually know what that means. So the next time in the book of Exodus we read about the commandment, you shall take care of the strangers, it says, you shall love the soul of the stranger. That is different. Knowing and loving the soul, you shall love the soul, that means that we need to look at them. We need to look at the other, because there are others as much as there shouldn't be, right? Because once we see their soul, once we see the soul of the stranger, it's very hard to hate them. The rabbis teach us, when we know the soul of a stranger, that is the moment that we can develop compassion. And when we have compassion, we have love. When we have compassion, we come from a place of love for the other, not fear of the other. Even before Exodus, and even before the middle of the middle, the Holiness Code, Leviticus, we have a story about strangers with Abraham, coalition of Abraham. We have a story about, you know this, the three men come to Abraham's tent. They're known as strangers. Tradition teaches that they're angels from God, messengers from God. Abraham, who had just circumcised himself, and how painful to think about, was sitting on a stool, sitting in front of his tent, and the three men come, and the Torah teaches that Abraham gets up eagerly to greet them. He doesn't say, who's there? He doesn't say, what do you want? He doesn't say, who sent you? He eagerly gets up in pain and says, come in. He provides water so they can wash their feet and gives them some food. Abraham, the very first monotheist, welcomes in the stranger. And from that, we learn one of the highest values of our tradition, hachnasat orchim in Hebrew. It's called hospitality, welcoming the stranger. No questions. Come in. Come into my home, and I will help you. This model of what it means to welcome the stranger began with Abraham. And it teaches us, and hopefully we'll be able to do this together in a little bit, it teaches that welcoming the stranger, helping the immigrant, the voiceless, the one who needs our help, doesn't have to start, and in fact doesn't start at the national level, but it starts with each one of us meeting someone else, maybe even for the very first time and saying, come in. Makes sense, yes? A few more things about what it means to welcome the stranger. When we received the covenant, the Torah, the Ten Commandments at Mount Sinai, we did not ask, what is in it for us? We trusted and said, we will do and we will hear. We didn't need to read the book first. We know that our purpose here is to fix the world. Fixing the world and all of its many problems, repairing what is broken, doesn't happen by letting somebody else do it. Each and every one of us, we understand, as children of the Holy One, as created in the image of the Holy One, has an obligation to fix the world, to welcome the stranger, and to provide for them, and to speak up for them. Strangers, those who we perceive are different, let's say the immigrant, doesn't share a native-born memory with us, or with those who are born here, doesn't share a past, doesn't share a belonging with so many people. But if you think about it, we all started from somewhere else. Come on! Mm-hmm. Our rabbis remind us that we have to be especially careful not to wound the stranger or the immigrant as saying they are not one of us. Sometimes a stranger is mentioned along with the poor. Sometimes a stranger is mentioned along with the widow or the orphan. On several occasions, the Torah teaches us, you shall have the same law for the stranger as the native born. And for us, all the rest is commentary. When a stranger lives among us, don't do him any wrong. Love him, love her as yourself. See the image of God in the other. That's our responsibility. That's how the world is repaired, one person at a time. Look forward to sharing and doing this with you in a few minutes.
Okay. We have two more traditions to hear from, but we also want to make sure that we get up and move a little bit and start to do exactly what the first two traditions have said, is to realize there is no other and to break through any sense of other by getting to know each other. So for about 5 to 10 minutes, we're going to challenge you to really live the first two teachings in this way. When I'm done, stand up and find one or two people that have a different tradition on their name tag, okay? And very simply, just ask you to share something you've heard or learned so far that you want to hold on to. That easy? Yeah? All right. So, something to know as we learn about each other's traditions. It's really important to many Muslim communities for non-related men and women to not shake hands. And the greeting, therefore, with many Muslim women and men, if you are of a different gender, would be to put your hand over your heart. So that's one thing we can all learn from the beginning. So please, we're gonna take about 10 minutes. Just go find someone from a different tradition. And you gotta, Vider students, you're gonna have to break out away from each other and hear something from them about what they like, and then we'll hear, take some large group responses, and then we're going to be blessed hearing about the Islam, the tradition of Islam and Christianity. Stand up, mix it up, and I'll tell you when to sit. Kind of get out in the mix too.
together because you're having so much fun getting to know one another. The temperature in the room seemed a little warm to me, so I opened a few windows. Please feel free to hop up and open more if you need it, or sit far away from a window if you're too cold. How about just a couple of comments? Any just a few sharing from the community? Yes.
Suggest one way that we get to become
better than me trying to translate.
I spoke with Nisar, is that how you pronounce it, from the Desplaines Mosque, and his idea for not becoming strangers anymore was to visit each other in our homes. Mm-hmm. I thought it was an incredible idea. Thank you, Nisar.
Thank you. Someone else want to share? If so, maybe come forward so you can... I don't know how far I have on my leash here.
Something that I loved hearing from Rabbi was how at Seders they invite a complete stranger into their home, or one or two, or as many as they'd like. And it kind of inspired a goal for me to go out of my way and talk to at least one stranger a week, and then maybe move it to like a day, just when I'm out in public, if I see someone, and just start a conversation, because sometimes you make the best of friends that way.
Isn't it? Yeah.
All right.
Others? Yes?
People of different faiths, kind of an idea came into my head. If anyone, kind of with thinking about like Christmas and Hanukkah, and I wish I could think of other religious celebrations and traditions, but if anyone is one of a different faith, to come and celebrate it with you, mm-hmm. to grow deeper in that understanding. So inviting perhaps one of your Muslim friends to Christmas, or some of your Christian friends to Hanukkah, and et cetera, to gain a deeper understanding of the beautiful parts of every faith. I thought that would be kind of a cool thing.
Good job.
Someone else, maybe someone from another tradition. Anyone?
Please.
Everyone suddenly got shy. I know you all were busy talking out there.
Here we go.
Oh, thank you.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Thank you.
So my name is Harleen, and I'm of the Sikh faith, and I had the pleasure of meeting Laura, who is Roman Catholic, and was speaking with Shar and Jody, who are Lutheran. And as we were just discussing, you know, similarities in each other's faiths, one of the key points that came out is, regardless of the faith, at some point in each person's faith, there is a call to make a commitment to God, personal commitment, whether you baptize, because I was explaining how in the Sikh faith you choose to take Amrit, or the baptism, and when I took the baptism, I took it at the same time as people who were 60, and there was discussion of just, you know, people taking it as children, but then there's confirmation, and then in other faiths, and so it was just, each faith calls you to make a commitment to God, and in a way, by being here, we're doing that, we are reaffirming that commitment to the Lord. Yeah.
That's beautiful.
Thank you. I'm doing a feeble attempt to tweet.
I'm sure it's very...
I'm not very good at it. Welcome the stranger.
All right, that's
so
great, thank you.
So if anyone wants to join in, if I'm
What's
being
your address?
This, I'm not being
What
mean.
Are you at? What?
Oh, I don't even know. Okay, wait a second. How do I find that out? I think it's...
I can call the White House. I think they know about these types of things.
E.B. Jameson 2, I think.
All right. Now, there is a wonderful spirit in our land right now that is rising up through some of the fear, misinformation, and darkness that we see. And it depends on what, especially like what Rabbi Bello said, people who are going out and making it happen. And I want to say that I've come to know the Muslim Community Center over the last month or so, and this is a center of holiness that is making this happen. We're going to welcome Imam Nazim Manjera. This community is continually trying to reach out, and God is blessing them through by bringing people to learn. I mean, they have a few locations. Their community in Elston hosted an open mosque. They hope for a couple hundred. They had over 1,000. So there, we can see light and hope. Imam Manjari is originally from Gujarat, India, and grew up in Toronto, Canada. At the age of 13, Imam Nazim went to England to complete the traditional memorization of the Quran and the Islamic scholar course. He excelled in his studies, which lasted for nearly 11 years. I could not have made it. In his final year of studies, out of a class of 56, he was tied for first place. So Imam Nazim is well known in speaker in community gatherings, universities, colleges, and mosques, where he has spoken on a wide range of interesting topics. And he has visited 15 countries. Mufti Nazim has 3 master's degrees, a master's in Arabic, in Islamic studies, and Islamic jurisprudence. He recently completed an Islamic judge course with respect to judicial separations. Currently, he is pursuing his doctorate in Islamic studies. How do you manage all this, Imam? The Imam can converse fluently in 4 different languages, and Mufti Nazim has 3 children and is happily married to an Islamic scholar. He has been an Imam at the Muslim Community Center, which is the location of Morton Grove and in north side of Chicago and in Skokie, and for over a year. From 2000 to 2004, he was a teacher at an Islamic school in Lombard. He returned to Chicago and after a decade of ministering in other cities. So please help me welcome Imam Nazim Manjari.
You guys enjoying the weather today?
Yes.
And it's so nice to see hundreds of people here, probably about 300, 400, 500. According to alternative facts, 1.5 million. 1.5 million. So as we hear from different faith traditions, we should all make an intention that we will just not leave it here to this room, but when we go back home, when we leave this beautiful space, that we will try to implement it in our day-to-day lives. So once one imam, he was giving the Friday sermon, and one person hearing the sermon, he said that, yes, I need to act upon this, because the imam was saying that when you go back home today, I want you to thank and praise and appreciate your wife for all these years of cooking for you, and you've never really thanked her. So he goes back home, and then, there's food on the table, and as he's eating the food, on the other side, he's appreciating and he's thanking his wife, and he's seeing that amazing cooking, amazing food, I'm really enjoying it in this and that. So he's praising the cooking and praising her, but on the other side, she's getting upset. She's not happy. So the person realizes that when my wife is not happy, I'm not gonna say anything more. So he stays quiet. And then afterwards, he talks to her that, honey, like, I was saying good things to you, why weren't you appreciating it? He says that for all these years, I've been cooking food for you, you never praised me, you never thanked me even once, you never appreciated, you never said anything nice once. Today you're praising this food, but the food is from the next door neighbor's house. So if you're ever gonna praise your wife about the food, make sure that you know where it's from. So this doesn't count in the minutes, this is just introduction.
Jokes are kindness.
Okay, so once again, thank you so much for giving us the opportunity to be present here, and it's my honor to be here. Now, I just want to get directly into refugees. And according to the 1951 Convention relating to the status of refugees, the definition is, a refugee is a person who, owing to a well-founded fear of being persecuted for reasons of race, religion, nationality, membership in a particular social group or political opinion, is outside the country of his or her nationality, and is unable to, or owing to such fear, is unwilling to avail himself or herself of the protection of that country. An unprecedented 65 million people around the world have been forced from home. Among them are nearly 21.3 million refugees, over half of whom are under the age of 18. Nearly 1 in 100 people worldwide are now displaced from their homes. There are also 10 million stateless people who have been denied the nationality and access to basic rights, such as education, healthcare, employment, and freedom of movement. We live in a world today where nearly 34,000 people are forcibly displaced every single day as a result of conflict or persecution. About 6 in 10 Syrians are now displaced from their homes, a number unprecedented in recent history for a single country. The Syrian conflict has displaced millions of citizens since protests against the Assad government began more than 5 years ago. Today, an estimated 12.5 million Syrians are displaced, up from less than 1 million in 2011, according to a Pew Research Center and analysis of global refugee data. Now, when we look in the history of the world, we see that so many prophets, they were immigrants. Many were refugees, and most prophets represented marginalized communities. Hashtag refuge to refugees. When a marginalized social class who converted to Islam faced severe persecution at the time of Prophet Muhammad, they were told that the Prophet of Islam, he told them to migrate to Ethiopia. This was one of the early encounters between Muslims and Christians when Muslims received support and encouragement from the Christian King Negus. The king's good behavior toward immigrants became an important reference for later Muslim-Christian relations. So here's a person, founder of a religion, and he's saying that you're being persecuted here, go to that certain country because there's a Christian king there who is fair, who is just, and who will treat you kindly and nicely. So these initial followers of Islam, they all migrated from the city of Mecca, and they went and stayed in Abyssinia. And the king there, even the Meccan people who are non-Muslim, they came to take these immigrants and refugees back to their country and to torture them and persecute them. But the Christian king said that, no, we have similar beliefs and faiths, and we have similar values, and because of that, they will be kept here. Now, in our world of bans, imagined borders, and undocumented immigrants, let us remember the lives of the prophets of Muslim, Jewish, and Christian tradition. Moses, Mary, Jesus, and the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon all of them, were all refugees, undocumented, and cast out of their homelands during their lives. Now today, when we look around the world, millions are left hungry. They're sleeping, and they have sleepless nights. They flee their homes. Many have been drowning in the seas because of undertaking a perilous journey, not by their choice. So we are once again fortunate, we're lucky that there are many people coming to our country, and America has always been a compassionate country. America is a compassionate place, and our religions and beliefs strongly urge us to be compassionate and caring. Why? Because we are all related, even though thousands of generations later, but we are all related because we all come from Adam and Eve. We're all related one way or another. And we see that even in the Quran, it advises us to protect every single life. As God mentions in the Quran, that مَنْ أَحْيَاهَا فَكَأَنَّمَا أَحْيَا النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا, that whoever saves and protects a life, whoever saved guards a life, it is as if they have saved all of humanity. And why is that? Because in every single one of us, we have the ability in all of us, we have the strength in all of us to impact the whole world. So when we take one person away from the world, it is as if we have killed all of humanity. So, dear respected guests, today, unfortunately, we see that around the world, because of injustices of human beings upon others, today we as humans, we are more scared of humans than animals. We are more scared of human beings than animals, because many human beings today, even though we might look like human beings, but we are not acting like human beings. But what we need to realize is that we are strong and stronger because of our diversity. We should never have this concept of the other. And that's why we respect all traditions and all beliefs, or even no beliefs, but I especially respect the people of the Sikh background. And the reason is because many times when there's violence perpetuated or violence acted upon the Sikh people, they never say that, hey, we're not Muslim, we're different. They never say we're different. They always say, and we all realize that we're all in this together. Even though just yesterday, a Sikh person in this country of Sikh background was shot. Fortunately, he's still alive, but the person who was shooting said that, get out of my country, get out of our country. So all the respect and kudos and all the, you know, full respect to you. So when we discriminate, when we imply by our actions that some lives are worth more than others, or when we denigrate the faith and traditions and cultures and choices of any group of people, we weaken our strength. Because then we lose safety and security when people are attacking each other. We look at so many countries in the world today, there's no safety, there's no security, because people are hurting each other, people are attacking each other. We don't want that to happen in this country, and especially because many more people have guns in this country compared to other countries. So when we are unjust, when we're hurtful, and when we're mean to others, then it spoils and it poisons the environment around us. And talking about poisoning or spreading love, we see that in our places of worship, that there's so much love being spread. You know, people of different backgrounds or no backgrounds here, you know, we're all here in the place of worship. You know, unfortunately today, nowadays, there's this environment trying to be created that, oh, religion is bad, religion is violent, and religion has caused a lot of wars. When we look in history, when we look at the statistics, less than 10% of wars and battles in the world have been because of religion. Less than 10. Even that is a lot. But we're talking about 90% has nothing to do with religion. A lot of times that happens not because of religion, it's because of the lack of religion in people. Because of the lack of faith and religion, because we don't value and we don't honor and respect other human beings and other people of other religions. So we need more religion in the environment today and not less. We see that our places of tradition, we spend hundreds and thousands of dollars for the poor and needy. I don't know specifically about your faith traditions, but Aramos, MCC, every single year we spend $250,000, $250,000, on anybody who comes through our doors, either Muslim, non-Muslim. They come for assistance and we provide them $250,000. If it wasn't for our faith traditions, I don't really think that people would be willing to spend so much money. So Christians, Jewish people, Sikh people, Hindu people, people of all religions, and even people of no religions, we're all in this together. So we need more religion and not less religion. Otherwise, we see that when we look at the causes of refugees and immigrants, one of the major causes is because of these political conflicts, not religious conflicts. And that's why, according to me, one of the biggest, a class of people, the biggest terrorists in the world are not people of religion. They're politicians and leaders of countries. Because it is the politicians who use their places of power and authority, and they incite the majority against the minority. And they make decisions, they make laws and rules and regulations, and because of that, people are oppressed in different countries of the world. So yeah, people try to blame religion for the violence, but a lot of times when you look in these recent conflicts, there's people making decisions that, you know, let's go and attack that country, and then hundreds and thousands and millions of people are displaced, and a lot of the times, it's usually because of the rulers and the oppressors and the tyrants ruling that country that they make it so difficult for people in that country to live their day-to-day lives that unfortunately they are forced to do things, they are forced to protest. And as soon as they start protesting, then violence is perpetuated and violence is meted upon such people. So we all need to make an effort to talk to our politicians and encourage them and remind them that for the sake of your seat and for the sake of your votes, don't be a cause of war, because all prophets, even Prophet Muhammad, he strongly discouraged from war. And he said that لا تتمنوا لقاء العدو, that don't ever desire to meet an enemy. There's no benefit, and there's so much chaos and destruction in war. So there's always discouragement from wars, and that's why we see that Prophet Muhammad, the day he passed away, his shield, it was mortgaged with a Jewish person. So it's not the teaching of Islam that somebody who's not Muslim, you have to attack them or you have to kill them, because if that was a part of teaching, then Prophet Muhammad's his shield, it would not have been mortgaged with a Jewish person till he passed away. And there were so many people of different religions living in that city of Medina. So the point here is that we as human beings, we need to learn how to live like human beings and not treat everybody else as the other. But we might disagree, We might not have the same beliefs, but that doesn't give us the reason to hate and to discriminate against each other. And I want to end with this interesting story that there was a person, old person, sitting on the riverbanks, and he was just enjoying the scenery, and it looked so nice. And then suddenly he saw that there was a scorpion in the water, struggling and trying to save itself from drowning. So this person, old person, reached out his hand to try to save the scorpion, and straight away, the nature of the scorpion is to bite, so the scorpion bit him. So he shouted and shrieked, and then moved his hand away, and then once again he reached his hand out to the scorpion, tried to protect it and save it again. Second time the scorpion bit him, he shouted again out of pain, and then the third time he did the same thing, and eventually he was able to save that scorpion. So there was another person sitting there, and it happens many times. You know, we're doing something and there's always people sitting on the side who never do anything, love to criticize, right? They love to criticize. They never volunteer or anything, but they're always pointing out faults and mistakes. So this person on the side, why are you doing this? Why are you painting yourself? You got stung by this scorpion many times. So he said an amazing thing. He said that the nature and the habit of the scorpion is to sting and to bite like that and to pain others. But my nature is I want to be helpful, I want to be kind, I want to be loving. So that's my nature. So I'm not going to let the nature of the scorpion overtake my nature. I'm going to do my responsibility, and that is I'm going to be kind and compassionate. It doesn't matter if the scorpion keeps on biting me or not. So around the world today, unfortunately, it will happen. Maybe our spouse, maybe our parents, maybe our children, our co-workers, neighbors, they'll always be biting us, they'll always be stinging us. They'll always be mean with us, but our duty and responsibility is to be kind and compassionate, irrespective of how other people interact with us. We need to show our good characters and morals and behaviors, and that's why it's so wonderful to see so many people here. Like even in our mosque, last few events, we had a walk, a rally, and we were only expecting a couple of hundred people. 1,500 non-Muslims came. And then a few weeks ago, we didn't expect that many people. More than 1,000 people came and stayed at our mosque for over a couple of hours. So, you know, unfortunately today, we might have a next door neighbor, but that 2-foot wall, that certain inch wall, it's such a huge barrier that we're living next to each other for so many years, decades, we don't even know their name. We've never even said hi to them. We've never really shared any friendship with them. We've never really invited them into our houses. So let's all make an intention that if nobody else in our street, at least our next door neighbor, we will get to know them. And as one person brilliantly mentioned, that every week they're going to try to get talk to somebody, approach somebody. So if you see somebody different, you know, go and talk to the person. I'm sure they will really appreciate it. So without, you know, so that was my, sit down, that was my introduction.
Imam, I don't know if you, when you're done with your doctorate, you may want to hit the road and do some comedy shows. This is out. Like to introduce now, I got too many papers up here. And here we go. Reverend Diane Shields is going to come forward. I have come to know her over the last months as a member of the guiding board for the Children of Abraham Coalition. She's a retired pastor from First Presbyterian Church in Arlington Heights for 20 years there. Now she is serving the community here at St. Simon's Episcopal. She is from a very diverse family because her children have married, and so her family includes Mexican, Ecuadorian, and Indian. And something else that's very striking to me is each year, Diane and her husband, Jerry, go to Ghana. And they minister as Christians in a predominantly Muslim community, not to evangelize, just to be present and to serve the people with their Muslim brothers and sisters. So here to offer the Christian tradition on welcoming the immigrants, Reverend Diane Shields. Thank you.
Shaki. Shalom. Salam. And grace and peace to all of you. Welcome. I just want to extend.
I might have turned off the mic by accident.
Is that better?
Yes.
All right. I want to extend to all of you, just on my own behalf, my gratitude for your being here today. It is encouraging that all of us come together, whatever our faith, because of our shared commitment to welcoming the stranger, because of its importance to us. We live in some challenging times today, and it is people of faith who are standing up, who are standing with, who are supporting and advocating for and providing sanctuary for refugees and immigrants, vulnerable and at risk among us. Our efforts are needed more than ever these days. As a Christian, our faith is rooted and grounded in Judaism. We are followers of Jesus, who was a Jew. He grew up in this tradition of welcoming the stranger. The scripture for him was the Torah. He knew the passages, the teachings. He was steeped in them. Do not mistreat or oppress the foreigner, because you yourselves were foreigners. You are to love them as you love yourself. Jesus himself was a refugee. His family fled to escape a brutal and murderous dictator, and they were welcomed. They were given sanctuary by people of another tradition, people of another faith, people of another culture. But Jesus went on to tell us that when we welcome the stranger, we welcome him. When we turn away the stranger, we are turning him away. For Christians, Jesus is God's word to us, God's revelation, God's demonstration, that God is not distant, separated, up there somewhere, but that Jesus and humanity, that God and humanity are joined together. We call it incarnation. God's Spirit indwells humankind. Humankind is holy and sacred. God is with us and in us and among us in our neighbors. Refugees and immigrants, people of every nation and race and culture and faith tradition, are all beautiful expressions of the image of God. Refugees and immigrants are those beautiful expressions of the image of God. They are God's children, they are our sisters and brothers, and we are one family. They are our family. All of our traditions teach us, I think, to love our neighbor. When Jesus was asked, "Who is your neighbor?" Jesus told a story about a Samaritan, someone of another culture, another race, another faith, who Jesus lifted up as a model and example of someone who brought love and mercy and grace. Immigrants and refugees bring God's love and mercy and grace to us. They are God's gift to us. They are God's presence with us. They are not the threats and dangers that they are so often portrayed to be. We live in challenging times. I don't know a time in my lifetime when I have felt that the stakes are higher or that it is more urgent for us to stand together as God's family, as people of faith. God has called us to be God's instruments, to, with faith and with courage, to bring God's mercy and grace and compassion to our neighbors who are in need. And I thank you from the bottom of my heart for all that you are doing. Thank you.
Thank you, Reverend Shields. Thank you so much to our tradition, you know, our Christian tradition. Thank you so much. Now we'd like to, we're going to let you meet even more people. Again, sharing something that has touched you from these two beautiful traditions. But then one more thing. We really invite you, as I think it's been said time and time again, and I think Imam Nazim, you said that real clearly, this can't stay here. The only reason we're here today is to leave. Right? The only reason we're here today is to leave. God, in all the traditions, God calls people to sacred spaces, but then says, okay, now go do something. And so we'd ask you, when I'm done, to find someone from a different tradition, someone new, that you didn't talk to the last little break, and share something that stuck out to you and you want to hold on to. But then, what are you going to do with this? You know, in this current political climate, what are you going to do to make these traditions come alive, to give blood, you know, and breath to them? So, and then we're going to come back and we're going to listen to some ideas from you, the faithful, on how do we make these traditions come alive in our political lives today, when there are people hiding, hiding out of fear of deportation, when synagogues, Jewish cemeteries are being defaced, when mosques are being subjected to bomb threats, when people who are of color or look differently are being shot in restaurants. There is no time to waste, and it doesn't matter what your age is. So, please, stand up, meet someone else new. Talk about something you want to take away and then something you want to do.
Thank you.
round of applause for her. In fact, I'm working, my full-time work is working with immigrants and interfaith issues like Children of Abraham Coalition, and we are working with a family, a Syrian family, who are living in the suburbs, and they're still waiting for permission for mom and the daughter to come here. They're waiting in the United Arab Emirates for our governmental processes to grant them permission. And Congresswoman Schakowsky has made a couple calls on that for us. Congresswoman is present at many events speaking for immigrants. She could not be present today. But we are honored to have one of our staff members who works on immigration and constituency issues, Adam Gajkowski. I didn't mangle it? Andrew. I was working on his last name. Andrew Gajkowski is going to share a few words about the Congresswoman's commitment to this issue. Thank you, Andrew.
Thanks a lot. As the father said, my name is Andrew. I'm with Congresswoman Jan Schakowsky's office. The Congresswoman would have loved to be here today, but she was unable to attend. I'm sure she'll be super pleased when I tell her about the speakers and all of you wonderful attendees. It's been a great event thus far. I just want you all to know the Congresswoman believes that our nation's diversity, whether it be country of origin, religious belief, point of view, it's an enormous source of strength to our nation. And here in the 9th Congressional District, which stretches all the way from here in Arlington Heights to Morton Grove, to Evanston, the north side of Chicago, up to Lake Michigan, is one of the most diverse districts in the entire country. I think that our communities are all stronger as a result, and the Congresswoman is very supportive of refugees and immigration efforts and all the rest. Each and every day, the Congresswoman is fighting on their behalf to try and protect the most vulnerable in our society. In Washington, she was a strong supporter of comprehensive immigration reform during the Obama administration. Now that we have President Trump, her efforts have been pretty much towards trying to stop things from getting worse in Washington. And if you have particular concerns about the immigration ban or about new policies that are being introduced, by all means, give our office a call. Here at home, the Congresswoman, as the father said, is working on individual cases where people are being deported wrongfully, where people are trying to get visas to come into the country, etc. If you need help with something like this, or if you know someone that needs assistance, I encourage you to give us a call. The Congresswoman's staff, including myself, are here to help. We have a number of immigration experts who can interface with the federal government to try and make that happen. So that's all I've got for you today.
Thank you, Andrew. We want to thank you for your work, your service to our country, and your service to the Congresswoman because of people who, like you, who give their lives over to public service, our nation is stronger. So thank you. From your last opportunity to meet, what are some things perhaps that you've learned, something that you're going to do?
Well, one of the things that I was speaking with Peg, who's active here. You see, we're getting inspiration here, but when we take it out somewhere in the world, as we're talking about spaces, there are sacred spaces, and every space is filled with something. Now, if we have inspiration and we would like to see good works come about in the world, then we must go and occupy that space. So in the burbs, you know, what are we up to? This space is beautiful. There are lots of spaces out there, and the impact that politicians, the policy wonks, and others are filling up the airwaves in other spaces. So there are some groups out there, a couple of whom that I've been working with recently. And I'd like to introduce you to them. We are in this together. WITT is a group that is working in the suburbs, and lots of people, exactly like you and I, who stepped up and tried to be a solution. Another one is Reclaim Chicago, which obviously, as we say, from Chicago, have elected a couple of people to office, because you can either sit back and hope that politicians will enact the types of policies that better this space and move forward those agendas, or you make sure that these politicians arise out of us, so that we're not sitting back and hoping, but in fact, we are the change that we'd like to see. Mm-hmm. Right? So this is a couple of things. I'm not endorsing anything else. Nope. These are things that I'm engaged in. I myself actually stood up to run for office for our library board. Right? Any one of us can do that. There's nothing.
Thank you, Gaurav. Who else would share something to do?
Hi, I'm Kyan. I'm part of the Children of Abraham Coalition. One thing we talked about was structuring your social gatherings in such a way that you're kind of forcing interfaith dialogue among people and being really intentional about who you converse with and who you talk to and who you kind of hang out with, so that the people you're hanging with don't realize that they're in an interfaith gathering until it's too late.
Good job, Simon. This young man, when we first formed our coalition and then formed a board to govern it, this young man was in eighth grade, and he's been with us every step of the way. He's now 48. So a round of applause for this young interfaith leader, who's a freshman at Harvard. Who else? Tayyip.
Thank you, Father. My name is Tayyip Rashid. I'm a U.S. Marine Corps veteran. I belong to the Ahmadiyya community. I belong to the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, Muslims who believe in the Messiah, Mirza Ghulam Ahmed of Qadian. And it's so refreshing, I must say, Father, you've done a fantastic job of getting all of us together. And I think one thing that I continue to learn over and over and over again is that it's very hard to hate someone that you've met, that you've shared or broken bread with, or that you've had a cup of coffee with. And this is exactly what is needed. See, the thing is that whatever's happened in the White House and whatever's happened in our politics, that's just a symptom of the problem. That's not the root cause. The root cause is that we don't know one another, right? So in this effort, I'll tell you, myself and other members of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, and really of other Muslim sects as well, we are more than happy, and we're eager to have this dialogue with people. So what we've done is launched the True Islam campaign. If you go on trueislam.com, and you can sign up to become a Muslim ally. Also, you will see that there's a section on there that says Coffee Cake in Islam. We have these coffee shop meetings set up for anybody to join. Come out. We would love to buy you a cup of coffee and answer any questions that you have. In fact, the thing is, there's so much misinformation about various faiths. I've heard all sorts of garbage about Judaism. I've heard all sorts of garbage about Christians, and of course, about my own faith as well. And I think until and unless we make the effort to meet one another, have those tough conversations and get to know one another, we're going to continue to have the kind of leaders that we have today. So my appeal to you would be to go out. That young lady said she's going to meet somebody new once a week. Kudos to you. That's exactly what needs to happen. So thank you so much, Father. Again, this is fantastic. I really appreciate all the work that you're doing.
Thank you. Let's have someone else.
What was that website so I can put it
on it?
TrueIslam.com. Thank you.
To dispel so many of the myths and hate-based misinformation that's being put out about especially Islam at this time.
Hi, my name is Edwina Cowellan. I'm the director of an interfaith curriculum organization online project for families and kids called Spiritual Playdates. And first, I want to say thank you so much, Father Corey, for doing this today. Father Corey is just so dynamic and has such phenomenal energy and ideas and gives them feet. And thank you for that.
I am not going to give you more money.
Okay. Okay. I want to piggyback on what the last gentleman said about educating ourselves and educating our kids. Someone mentioned, you know, invite someone to your home for a holiday. That can be intimidating. If you're a Christian and you invite a Jewish person to your home for Christmas, they're thinking, oh, okay, they want me to learn all about their faith. What I invite you to do is to go out into the community and learn about the other faiths. Educate yourselves. Go to Gurdwara. And if you've never had a langar, oh my God, are you in first prize. Go out there. There are so many houses of worship that are just incredible and rich and fascinating, and you will meet incredible people. So I urge you to educate yourselves about other faiths and other traditions. You know, open your eyes a little bit and get out there and be the stranger. The other thing I would suggest is to start with the children. That is, I beat the drum all the time about this. Our kids are sort of steeped in one tradition. They're not really exposed to anything else. And they have no context. They learn Islam, they learn Christianity, whatever it is that they learn, but they don't really learn about the other faiths of the world, sometimes until high school. And it's part of the problem. It's part of what's gotten us here, is because we don't understand anything else about these traditions and these people, and they're exotic and they look different, and who are they? So I urge you to consider working with your kids and in your religious ed groups. Find out if they're, you know, being exposed to anything else and meeting other folks and kids of other traditions. So that would be I'm a member of On and On and On, so.
SpiritualPlayDate.com. It's great resources that can expand existing religious ed programming or even offer it on its own that teach kids the beauty of other traditions. So SpiritualPlayDate.com. Thank you. You're supposed to say it three times, I think. That's what you hear on the radio. One more. Can we have one more person? Yes, Khadija.
I just have a really small quote to share that I just seen the room around here. Where there's unity, there's always victory. So just remember that. Speak up. There's going to be victory. Victory is going to follow you everywhere. So thank you for being here.
As has been said, there is a no time to waste. The administration wants to hire thousands of new immigrant enforcement officers to increase deportations. And we will have a new Muslim ban, which is exactly what it is, coming out within days. So what else can we do? On your way out, we offer you some suggestions. One is, and first, most importantly for all of us here, and you will find these handouts on the ledges and on the sign-up table if you're interested on your way out. Optimistically, I made 150 thinking, well, we'll have some extra, but, you know.
We made more.
First, we invite you to pray. All our traditions come back to the fact that we're not in charge, and that if we're not praying, we are probably going off track. So God, the one God, the beneficent God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, Jesus, wants to show us what to do. How much time are we spending praying for guidance? Learn. You heard about that. Learning from meeting new folks, but even more important, we are in a stage, unfortunately, where the administration is focused on sending out information that is really misinformation quite often. And unfortunately, it's just verified time and time again. So you need good information. God, the other thing we all recognize is God has given us maybe one of our greatest gifts, and that is a brain. But we need, in a Christian term is called discernment. And it means discerning truth from falsehood, unreality from reality. So there are some really good websites out there. Look for really good news. There is one called the Center for Migration Studies that is on the handout sheet. You can also find, I think, each faith tradition probably has a website that will give you accurate information about immigration issues. We've heard meet, break bread with each other. hear stories of the journeys of immigrants. I'm honored to be part of the co-director of a new ministry called Viator House of Hospitality in the suburbs, where we are welcoming into a residential program 18 to 22-year-old men who are seeking asylum. We're interfaith because they are Christian Muslims, and we've had a Hindu with us as well. Meet and hear the stories of our recent immigrant brothers and sisters. So you have information on how you can do that. Unite. It's been said so many times. We are strong if we don't let ourselves be divided. So we got to stay united. I invite you to stay close to the Children of Abraham Coalition's Facebook page, Facebook group, for looking for information, or even email to get on our emailing list. We have great things coming up. Talked about young people. We will unveil this June, the end of June, first ever in Chicago area, Peace Camp, where we seek to bring together junior high kids from different traditions to get to know each other and to respect. And it's not just respecting other traditions, it's cherishing other traditions, seeing the beauty of other traditions, and realizing that my tradition and who I am is lessened if I am not in relationship with the other traditions. My vision of God is too small if I am not partnering with men and women of other traditions. So please stay connected with us. And then finally, act. On the sheet, you will see a phone number to call Congress. You can go right to your congressional representative. Even if your congressional representative, like Congresswoman Schakowsky, is supportive, they want to know that you're right, Andrew? They want to know. So you can support the current legislation called the Bridge Act, which would protect young men and women who've brought here as minors without documents, and protect them from deportation and give them a pathway to legalization. And finally, rally. There is another, and this is on the sheet, another group that I'm honored to be part of called Protected by Faith, Chicago Area Interfaith Leadership Group, that is trying to rally and march to wake up all parts of our governmental system to what the people really want, what we really stand for. Before we end, please make sure on your way out you grab one of these handouts. And before we say goodbye, I would like to invite, before we say goodbye and thank you to this wonderful St. Simon's community, I would like to invite the co-founder of the Children of Abraham Coalition, Shaheen Khan, from the Islamic Education Center, come forward and offer a prayer to end our gathering, and then a thank you and goodbye from them.
Thank you, Father Corey, and thank you to St. Simon and all the wonderful people that joined today. Let's begin our prayer. In the name of God, the Beneficent, the Merciful, we are thankful for St. Simon for opening the door today to all of us and to all the beautiful leaders who spoke. Oh God, we are thankful to you for bringing us closer than what we were yesterday. Help us spread this bond further to those who are not here with us today. Help to see the immigrants from your point of view and not from behind closed doors, closed borders. Help us critically think when we hear news from the news channel. Help our journalists to work for you and not report what sells at the moment. Help us stand up for the vulnerable, for we know your mercy is on them and in you. Help the refugees as they are forced to leave their home, not at their choice, as they look for another land, which they hope to call it home. Help us understand that we are ambassadors of the prophets who taught us to serve others before ourselves, that they were asked to migrate to different lands, perhaps for us to know how to deal with our situation that we are facing today. Help us understand your message, to do unto others what we want done to us. We are thankful for the immigrants who have made this country rich and would like to make it richer with your help. You have created us all, and you know all our needs. help us create a world of empathy and understanding without borders. May we see everyone just as you see us all. We are thankful for the immigrants, for if they were not sent here from different places, we would not have had the diversity and richness that we have today. For you have stated in the Quran that you have created us male and female and made us into tribes and families that we may know each other. Surely the most honorable among us with you is the one amongst us who is most pious. God, help us be one. Amen.
Shaheen asked me to make an announcement. April 27th, the Daughters of the Children of Abraham, and we would invite Sikh daughters who might be interested to join, and that's at Vider at 6-7 o'clock on the 27th of April. You can see one of us if you want more information. In our tradition, after a final blessing, we have a sending. Can I do a sending?
Yes.
Life is short, and we do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who make the journey with us. So be swift to love, make haste to be kind, and the blessing of God who made us, who loves us, and who travels with us, be with you now and forever.
And I want to thank this incredible rector of, and the staff and the wonderful people of St. Simon's Episcopal for this great hospitality and this warm home they have provided. Thank you very much, Elizabeth. And
close.
We're 302. That's not bad. As we go forward, I think the last words that I would like to proclaim are the words that I think we all know from our faith traditions, that the words that come spontaneously when we see the beauty of God as we have seen this day in each of our faiths. And that would be, Alhamdulillah, Baruch Hashem, Vayiguru, praise God. Have a great afternoon.
About how education is a gateway to understanding between the religions. Even though we may not know something about another religion, hate is not an excuse for violence. I learned that all our religions have common common beliefs. Although we express them in different ways, it's important to realize that we're all human and we're all deserving of human rights and human dignity.
And so I grew up as the child of an immigrant, but in a Muslim country. I didn't move back to the States until I was 18. It was a great experience for us. And my parents grew up in small towns in the U.S., so they chose not to live in those typical American communities that you have abroad. So we lived in a professional community. We have lots of friends. Went through turbulent times. Our experience was just so different than how immigrants are treated here now. I'm ashamed. It's shameful.
From the Roman Catholic faith tradition, and I love to see all of God's creation, all of humanity, together as one. And this is a beautiful event, and I would like to see more of these throughout the Chicago metropolitan area, the country, and the world. This is what's needed. Thank you so much.
It's been a nutty winter. I admit, I have no business.
I think one of the things that we learned here is that there is one God, and that we are all made in the image of God, B'Tselem Elohim, and that xenophobia is in fact blasphemy. Coming together with other faith cultures, with people from other nations, with the immigrant, with the poor, this is the kind of unity we need in this land, because that's what defines this land, and that's what defines our humanity. So, salam, shalom, and peace. Thank you.
I'm Rachel Bobrin, I'm from the Episcopal tradition.
And I'm Chad Bobrin, I was raised Jewish.
And we just really had a wonderful afternoon meeting new friends from different traditions, and we really look forward to more opportunities to connect with others, break bread, and share in our common experience.
I really enjoyed to hear the similarities across all of the religions and cultures. There's many differences in rituals and traditions, but as a whole, it's all about love and community and bringing people together. And I enjoyed hearing that and hope to spread that beyond. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.